Great to be with you again. Welcome back to CBSE Plus 2 English class. Today we're gonna discuss yet another interesting lesson from Vistas, that is Evans Trials on All Level. Are you all ready to listen to the class? If you are ready, let's begin. Before we begin the lesson, let's watch a video. We'll come back after watching it.
It could either break you or make you, and if it breaks you, you know what, you're just gonna just be broken, physically and mentally. Oh, I haven't seen a tree or a plant since 2003.
The only thing that I've seen is a spider in the corner, and I find them little bugs sometimes and I feed the spider. That's about the only closest thing to nature I have.
It's not to the point where you want to commit suicide. And sometimes I'm at the point that we want to write the judge and say, just give me the death penalty. Just give me the death penalty, man.
Our cell 22 and a half hours a day, and then our yard is just brick walls.
I'm not able to go out to a yard and eat with other people. If I'm not able to see things around me, whether it's trees, grass, birds, to talk to my family, to get sunlight.
You had people in here that's been in solitary confinement longer than I've been alive.
If you could put every emotion of the human spirit of hopelessness, pain, agony, hatred, frustration, a sense of continuous silently screaming, all these emotions in while you're locked in this cage treated like some animal, most people wouldn't even treat an animal like that. An animal who was suffering pain, they would take him to the vet and do something for him.
Like, I had to take a lot of deep breaths before I came in here. Just being around people, it's not an awkward, it's a good feeling, but it's still an anxiety feeling because I haven't been, it's like, wow, I'm around free people. I'm around regular people.
This is a behavior modification, psychological, low-intensity warfare against the mind of a human being. That's what exists here at Pelican Bay.
It's the same thing day in and day out.
It's just psyching ourselves out to make the best of the day.
It's kind of robotic. If you just spoke to 100 guys today, you would do the same thing. I get up in the morning,
up,
I wash up, I drink my coffee.
Roll up my mattress,
I get up, I brush my teeth. I'll drink some coffee.
Drink water.
Brush my teeth again.
Clean the cell.
Clean the seat.
Wipe the floor, the walls.
You do certain things just to fill up that time.
Where you can hear the vent and you focus on it. Like, man, did I just hear a whisper right now? And the person starts focusing on this little noise because the noises and the vision are the senses. And that's what we have to constantly survive. But if I had a window to look out, I think if they came by every half an hour, I'd be sitting in that window.
Yes, I committed a crime to come to prison, but don't make the assumption that my current situation here being Pelican Bay SHU is due to my continuous criminal behavior, because I have grown that a long time ago.
Humankind has a history of ugliness, and humankind also has a history of beauty. It's in all of us, and you need laws to have a society not go into chaos. Ultimately, people have the ability to look at what is bad and good in a way that is not insulting, not aggressive, not with bullets. Through psychology, creating a better understanding of each other, everybody deserves a chance. Thank you for taking your time to hear my voice, because our voices are rarely heard. Okay.
Dears, what's the video about? Yes, it's about prisoners, and you have heard the voice of some inmate. They describe about their troubles, facilities, etc. inside prison, right? Nowadays, all of us are caged in the four walls of our home due to COVID-19 pandemic. And we lost all our freedom and experiences some sort of imprisonment, right? But we all know that the situation is only temporary. It will be over soon and we'll come back to our normal life, right? But have you ever thought of the life of prisoners? Do they get their facilities to enjoy their freedom inside the jail? Do they get the facility to fulfill their dreams inside jail? Let's see. You people may be thinking that why I'm discussing about prisoners, right? Our lesson is related to a clever prisoner. Shall we begin? Yes, today's lesson is Ivan Streisand Oliver, written by Colin Dexter. About the author, Norman Colin Dexter was an English crime writer known for his Inspector Moore series of novels, which were written between 1975 and 1999. His famous books are Last Bus to Woodstock, The Remorseful Deed, The Way Through the Woods, etc. Let's move on to the lesson. Children, Ivan Streisand Oliver is a detective fiction. Let's see the dramatis personae, or the central characters of the lesson. The secretary of the examination board, okay? The first character is the secretary of the examination board. The governor of HM Prison, Oxford. Okay, governor of HM Prison is the name of a prison in Oxford. The third comes Evans, okay, James Evans. He's a prisoner and he is the central character of our lesson. James Evans. Next comes Mr. Jackson, a prison officer, and Mr. Stevens, a prison officer. So Mr. Jackson and Mr. Stevens, both are prison officers at Oxford Prison. Next comes the Reverend S. McCleary, an invigilator. Okay, Reverend, he's a priest. Okay, a priest is McCleary. Reverend McCleary is an invigilator. Mr. Carter, detective superintendent. Mr. Bell, detective chief inspectors. These are the characters in our lesson. Should criminals in prison be given the opportunity of learning and education? Let's see. Ivan Streisand Oliver, written by Colin Dexter. All precautions have been taken to see to erect the O-level German examination arranged in the prison for Evans does not provide him with any means of escape. It was in early March when the secretary of the examinations board received the call from Oxford Prison. It's a slightly unusual request, Governor, but I don't see why we shouldn't try to help just the one fellow you see. That's it. Chap called Evans started night classes in O-level German last September. Says he's dead keen to get some sort of academic qualification. Is he any good? He was the only one in the class, so you can say he's had individual tuition all the time, really. Would have cost him a packet if he had been outside. Well, let's give him a chance, shall we? That's jolly kind of you. What exactly the procedure now? Oh, don't worry about that. I'll be sending you all the forms and stuff. What's his name? You say Evans? James Roderick Evans. It sounded rather grand. Just one thing, Governor. He's not a violent sort of fellow, is he? I don't want to know his criminal record or anything like that. But No, there's no record of violence. Quite a pleasant sort of chap. They tell me, bit of a card, really. One of the stars at the Christmas concert. Imitations, you know, the sort of thing, my dear Woodstock. No, he's just a congenial kleptomaniac. That's all. The governor was tempted to add something else, but he thought better of it. He'd look after that particular side of things himself. Our central character name is James Evans. He's a prisoner. He's keenly interested to get some sort of education qualification. Okay, educational qualification he wants to get. That is his wish. So, he wants to write German O-level examination. Okay, so the officers in the jail, they arranged everything. All the precautions have been arranged for Evans to write the O-level German examination, and also they made all the arrangements, okay, the security arrangements, because Evans should not escape from the jail, okay, while writing the examination or preparing for the examination, he should not escape from the jail. So, all the arrangements, even for the examination as well as for the security, all the arrangements have been made, okay? And now, here begins our lesson. This is the background of the lesson, okay? Just listen again. James Evans, he is a prisoner. He wants to write German O-level examination because his wish is that he wants to get some educational qualification in his life, okay? So, being a prisoner, he just wants to get it. That is his vision, okay. So, the officers in the jail, they made all the arrangements. They provided the facilities for Evans. They arranged everything, okay. All the precautions have been arranged for him. And even the security arrangement also finished. Now, here begins our lesson. In the early March, the examination board secretary, the secretary of the examination board, he receives a call from Oxford prison. Who called him? Yes, of course, it's a governor, chief officer from the prison. He called the examination board secretary and announced that or informed him that a man, his name is Evans, he is keenly interested to write O-level German examination. So, the secretary must provide all the facilities, okay? That is the request from Oxford prison governor, okay? So, the secretary really, he says that it's really difficult to arrange an exam inside prison. At the same time, only one person, for that person, the board examination should be arranged in prison. You people all know that what are the things we must arrange for a board examination, okay? So, if a lot of people are there, we can do that. At the same time, only one chap means fellow, only one fellow, his name is James Evans. For him, it's really difficult to arrange the facilities for board examination inside the jail. Okay, that was the reply of the secretary of board of examination. Okay, at the same time, the governor of the jail, he says that this person, James Evans, he is keenly interested to get an academic qualification in his life. For that, already he had started the class, 9 classes and everything arranged inside the jail, okay. In the September itself, he started learning German O-level examination, okay. Why? Because he wants to get that qualification in his life. Understood? That is his vision. For that purpose, early September, he started his course. And even the teachers were arranged there inside the prison. And really, it was expensive for the officers, okay? But a person wanted to get an education means we must provide, okay? That is the views of the officers. That's why they arranged the 9 classes for Evans. Now, he starts studying his O-level examination. So, from board side, you must provide all the facilities. That was the request of the governor. So, the secretary agrees. He says that, okay, if he has that much interested, we can provide all the facilities. He says like that, okay. And next question, the examination secretary, board of examination, that secretary asks our officer or the governor that, how sort of he, means that, what sort of a person is Evans, okay. That was his question. Because Board examination is going to arrange inside the jail and they must know the background of the candidate, right? So he asked the governor what sort of a person is Evans. So the governor says that actually he is not a violent sort of person, clear. A normal type only, he is a very jovial person and also he knows imitating people, that means mimicry, okay, that he used to do in his life, okay, that means he enjoys mimicry, he just used to imitate people, that was his habit. Only one problem he has, he is a kleptomaniac, okay, kleptomaniac means a person who used to steal things from others, okay, because of that only he came to the prison, okay, that was understood, clear. See, actually he is a kleptomaniac. Kleptomaniac means a person who used to steal things from others, okay, that is his nature. And one more thing also the governor wants to add about Evans, but he just started saying about that, but he did not reveal it to the secretary, okay, he just hide it, clear. Presumably, said the secretary, you can arrange a room where, no problem, he is in a cell on his own. If you have no objections, he can sit the exam in there. That's fine, and we could easily get one of the persons from St. Mary Max to invigilate if that's fine. Yes, they seem to have a lot of persons there, don't they? The two men chunked good naturedly, and the secretary had a final thought. At least there's one thing, you shouldn't have much trouble keeping him incommunicado, should you? The governor chuckled politely once more, reiterated his thanks, and slowly cradled the phone. Evans got the permission to write his all-over German examination from the board. Understood. And the secretary asked our governor that you must arrange a separate room for Evans to write the examination. That time, governor replies, already he is kept in a single room, a cell, different, separate cell for Evans. Now, you people should get that, okay? Evans is kept in a separate cell, okay? So, when it happens, you people know that, okay, if a person is separated in a cell means something dangerous. You people know, okay? So, now the governor says that he is kept in a separate cell. So, if the secretary agrees, he can write the exam in his cell. Okay, that was the reply from our governor. And now, our secretary also agrees because he stays alone in the cell. Okay, so you provide all the facilities for the examination there inside that cell itself. That will do. That is the reply from the secretary. At the same time, secretary says that you must keep him incommunicado. Incommunicado means he should not speak to anyone while writing the examination. You people know that all the precaution must be taken and he should not communicate with anyone. Okay, should be kept inside that jail. Okay, inside the cell. That was the reply from the secretary. Okay, so you just listen. That time our governor also agrees. No problem, we will provide all the facilities for Evans to write his examination, that too in his own cell. Clear. That time, secretary of board of examination, he says that, okay, then from board side, we'll arrange an invigilator. That invigilator will come from St. Mary's Max, okay. That means a church. St. Mary's Max means it's a church only. There, many persons are there. Persons means who used to learn priesthood. Okay, person means the people who used to learn priesthood. Many persons are there. We'll arrange one person from there and he would come to your jail and invigilate Evans examination. Okay, that is the reply from the secretary from board of examination. Okay, now our governor also agrees. Okay, that is good because a person means we can all trust him. Okay, persons or priest. So that will be fine. You can send the invigilator to the jail. We'll arrange all the facilities inside the cell. Governor agrees that and he cradled the phone back. Because through phone only they both were talking, understood? And he kept the phone back to the cradle. And the governor called for Evans. He called Evans. Evans the Brake, as the prison officers called him. Thrice he had escaped from prison, but for the recent wave of unrest in the maximum security establishments up north, He wouldn't now be grazing the governor's premises in Oxford, and the governor was going to make absolutely certain that he wouldn't be disgracing them. Not that Evans was a real burden, just a persistent nagging presence. He would be all right in Oxford, though the governor would see to it personally. And besides, there was a just possibility that Evans was genuinely interested in Oliver Jermyn, just a very slight possibility. At 8:30 p.m. on Monday, 7th June, Evans' German teacher shook him by the hand in the heavily guarded recreational block just across from Deaving. Guten Glück, Herr Evans. Pardon? I said good luck. Good luck for tomorrow. Oh, thank you, Alman Dankeschön. You haven't a cat in hell's chance of getting through, of course, but I may surprise everybody, said Evans. At 8:30 the following morning, Evans had a visitor, two visitors, in fact. He tucked his grubby string vest into his equally grubby trousers and stood up from his bunk, smiling cheerfully. Morning, Mr. Jackson, this is Entwiedenaar. Jackson was the senior prison officer on D Wing, and he and Evans had already become warm enemies. At Jackson's side stood Officer Stevens, a burly, surely loving man only recently recruited to the profession. Jackson nodded curtly, and how's our little Einstein this morning then? Wasn't a mathematician, Mr. Jackson. I think he was a Jew, Mr. Jackson. So when the governor put the phone back to the cradle, he just pronounced the word Evans, okay? Actually, now we just get the background of Evans, clear why he kept in a single cell and all. Listen carefully. Actually the prison officers or the police officers calls Evans as Evans the Brake. Okay, means that thrice he escaped from the jail. Okay. See, he's very clever in breaking jail and escape. Understood? That's why he kept in a separate cell. Understood? If whatever the facilities are there or the security systems, he is capable of escaping from jail. That's why now in the D wing is a special wing near to the governor's office. They kept a separate cell for Evans, and Evans stays inside that cell. Why? Because the governor can observe him directly. For that purpose, they kept a special cell in the D wing near to governor's office, and Evan stays there alone. Okay. And actually, he's really a nuisance for the officers. Okay, really a headache for them. Every time they must take care of this person. Okay, why? Because if he gets a single chance, he must utilize it and escape from jail. That's why. So really, he is a nuisance for them. Now, he got the permission to write the examination. So the officers must be very careful, right? Now, this is the month of June. At early 8:30, two teachers, okay, they just brought Evans to the governor's office because he's going to write the examination. Now, they must inform him about the permission and all. That's why they brought Evans to the governor's office, to the recreational room through D wing. They just came everywhere. Tight security was there, okay. And then Evans came to the governor's office. When Evans reached in front of the governor or the chief officer, the officer just wished him good luck, okay. So Guten Glück, he said. That's a German word. Guten Glück, he said. That time, Evans didn't understand. He asked that, pardon, what is it? I didn't get. So, the governor says, I wish you good luck. Why? He asked. Because Evans didn't get to know that he got permission to write the examination. Okay. That time, governor informed him that he got permission to write the examination at the same time. Are you really interested in writing examination? Like that, they asked. Because still the officers, they have the doubt that whether Evans is really interested to get some academic qualification in his life or not, okay, or some other intention is behind it that they do. So they asked. At the same time, governor says that you got the permission, you must utilize, you should just write the examination properly, should not hide any other intention, okay, means that should not try to escape or should not play any tricks. So you got the permission, you can write the examination inside yourself, okay? That only who announced our governor informed Evans. Clear? Evans agreed and the officers brought him back to his cell. And the very next day, only his examination, okay? The very next day he's going to write the examination. So early morning, two officers, they came and stood in front of Evans' cell. One was the police officer Jackson, okay? He's a senior prison officer. And already Evans and this officer became thick enemies, okay? Why? Because of Evans' character, Jackson doesn't like Evans. So Jackson just came and stood in front of the cell and asked Evans that, "How are you, little Einstein?" Okay, means that Jackson wants to tease him because he's going to write examination and want to get something in his life, like that way Jackson thinks. And he asked that, "How are you, little Einstein?" Like, so Jackson asked this to Evans. Evans also replies in a funny way only. I think he is a mathematician and a Jew. Like, he just replied in that way. Even Evans also knows that Jackson doesn't like him. Okay. At the same time, along with Jackson, another officer also was there. His name is Stephen, a newly appointed police officer. Okay. Both were there because they both got the duty of Evans. Okay. That day, the examination day, they must guard or just give all the security arrangements there near the cell. Okay. Who were they? Two prison officers. One is Stephens and the other one is Jackson. And they just came and stood in front of his cell. Who said? Evans' cell. And they just started talking. I told you Jackson and Evans, they became both became thick enemies. Okay. Now these two officers only got the in charge of Evans while writing the examination. Clear? Evans' face was unshaven and he wore a frilly looking red and white bobble hat upon his head. "Give me a chance, Mr. Jackson. I was just going to shave when you questioned." "Which reminds me," Jackson turned his eyes on Stephens, "make sure you take his razor out of the cell when he's finished scraping that ugly mug of his. Clear? One of these days he'll do us all a favor and cut his bloody throat." For a few seconds, Evans looked thoughtfully at the man standing ramored straight in front of him. A string of Second World War medals proudly paraded over his left breast pocket. "Mr. Jackson, was it you who took my nail scissors away?" Evans had always worried about his hands. "And your nail filed you." Look, for a moment, Evans' eyes smoldered dangerously, but Jackson was ready for him. "Orders of the governor, Evans," he leaned forward and leered, his voice dropping to a harsh, contemptuous whisper. "You want to complain?" Evans shrugged his shoulders lightly. The crisis was over. "You have got half an hour to smarten yourself up, Evans, and take that bloody hat off." "Me at her." Evans put his right hand lovingly on top of the filthy woolen and smiled sadly. "Do you know, Mr. Jackson, it's the only thing that's ever brought me any sort of luck in life. Kind of lucky charm, if you know what I mean. And today I thought, well, with me, exam and all that." Buried somewhere in Jackson was a tiny core of compassion, and Evans knew it. So both the officers, they just stand outside, okay? And that time, Jackson saw that Evans was unshaven. Okay, you people know that if you want to go write the board examination, everything must be in a proper way. Okay, so Evans wants to shave his face. Yesterday, the previous day, they had given a razor to him. Now he wanted to do it. So Evans says that, "Actually, I wanted to smart up myself. That time only you people came. Now give me half an hour. I'll just get ready for the examination," he says. So previous night, he got the razor and that time he started shaving his face. So Jackson says to our another officer, his name is Stephens, to Stephen that, "Stephen, you must do one thing. After shaving, you make sure that you get back the razor." Okay, why? Because with that razor also Evans can do something. Okay, so after shaving, you must take that razor back from him. That order who gives our senior officer, his name is Jackson. He orders this to the recently appointed officer, his name is Stevens. Okay, so after shaving that, you get the razor back. That was the order. And that time he was just shaving. Okay, who was shaving? Evans was. So Jackson says that nowadays he can do all a favor is that, okay, we need a favor from him while shaving, he can cut his throat and die, okay, then we all will be safe, like that Jackson says. Now you people think that how dangerous Evans is, okay. So what he says that while shaving he can cut his throat and die, and that is will be a great favor for we all people, like that all of us, okay, that only he says. And now Evans Tucker just doing his work and all, he wanted to smart up himself for the examination. And while doing that, these both the officers, they were just standing outside. Now Evans is always worries about his nails. He wants to get the nail scissors to trim his nail. So he searched for it, but he didn't get that time. He wants to make Jackson a bit angry. For that, he asked that, Jackson, did you see my nail scissors? He asked that. Okay, so Jackson said that. Jackson got angry because he's an officer. He's an officer, and Evans asked him about his nail scissors. Okay, so he said that if you talk too much, I'll take your nail files. Okay, I'll just take your nails out. That only Jackson replies. And that time Evans got angry of that reply. So Evans started fuming. So Jackson says that, do you want to complain about me? You want to complain against me? Like that Jackson asked. So Evans wants to just act rudely, okay. At the same time, Evans know that if he behaves so, sure, that permission would be cancelled, okay. He would never get the chance to write the examination. So he controlled all the anger, okay, with himself only. And Jackson got that opportunity. He says that, Evans, you got the permission to write the examination, but if you try to do something, we'll just sheer complain it and that permission would be cancelled, okay? So behave properly, like that Jackson warned him. Clear? Now, Evans also knows that he wants to write, his intention is that he wants to write the examination, okay? And, you know, Evans always used to wear a cap, okay? A dirty hat there. On his head, over his head, he used to wear the hat. That time Jackson says that while writing your examination, you must remove this dirty hat off. Okay, he asked this to Evans. So Evans says that this hat, oh, this is my lucky charm. Okay, this hat, whenever I wear this hat, it will bring some sort of luck to me. So I consider my hat as a lucky charm. Especially today, I'm going to write my examination. So I consider my hat as my lucky charm and I will never remove it, he says. Okay. And you people never come to know that what sort of a luck this hat is going to bring for me. That you will never come to know like that, he says. Okay. And he says that I want to wear this hat while writing the examination to the officers. Okay. So anyhow, his time up, he wants to prepare for the examination, okay? He's smarting up himself for the examination, okay? Just this once, then Shirley Temple, if there was one thing that Jackson genuinely loved about Evans, it was his long wavy hair and get shaving. At 8:45 the same morning, the Reverend Stuart McClary left his bachelor flat in Bow Street and stepped out briskly towards Carfax. The weatherman reported temperatures considerably below the normal for early June, and a long black overcoat and a shallow crowned clerical hat provided welcome protection from the steady drizzle, which had set in half an hour earlier and which now spattered the thick lenses of his spectacles. In his right hand, he was carrying a small brown suitcase which contained all that he would need for his morning duties, including a sealed question paper envelope, a yellow invigilation form, a special authentication card from the examinations board, a paper knife, a Bible he was to speak to the Women's Guild that afternoon on the Book of Ruth, and a current copy of the Church Times. The two-hour examination was scheduled to start at 9:15 a.m. what happened? Ivan starts smarten up himself. Okay. Actually, Jackson and Ivan became enemies. I told you, becomes enemies. At the same time, Jackson has a soft corner about Ivan. Okay. One side, he just loves him. That soft corner is there. Okay. So, Ivan just, he was getting ready that time. Jackson says that you must do it fast. Okay. At the same time, Jackson doesn't like one thing in Ivan, that is his long hair. Okay. That dirty long hair that he doesn't like. Who doesn't like? Jackson doesn't like. Because Ivan has a long hair. And he says that you just shave fast and get ready fast because exam time is up. That's why. That is the scene in the jail. And now outside, we just move on, okay, to that church. St. Mary's Mag, that's the name of the church. From there only the invigilator comes, okay. His name is Reverend S. McLaren, okay. Reverend S. McLaren is the invigilator, okay. So, he comes from the St. Mary's Mag. That's the name of the church. And Reverend means, what is it? Reverend S. McLaren is a person. Person means, he just studies for priesthood, okay. He's a priest. So, he just starts from his bachelor flat, okay. He wears a long black coat and wore a hat also. Took a suitcase, and in that suitcase he arranged everything: question paper, paper envelope, paper knife, authentication card for invigilation duty. Okay, you must get that identity card for doing the duty. Okay, so he took that and a copy of Bible, because after the examination afternoon he wants to go and take that class for women group. He wants to take a class based on the lesson, the Ruth, okay, from the Bible. For that, he kept the Bible inside, and that newspaper, church time newspaper also, he took and kept everything arranged in the suitcase, okay. So, what were they? The authentication card, question paper, paper knife, paper envelope, okay, and church time, and also Bible he kept inside the newspaper, sorry, suitcase. And he wears a long black coat and hat, came out of his bachelor flat and starts moving to the jail, okay, for doing his duty. That day, the weatherman reports that the weather is comparatively very low, okay, that means the temperature is very low, it may rain, okay, that is the weather report. So, when Ms. McLaren, Reverend McLaren starts moving forward, it was drizzling, okay. And he just starts moving towards the jail because examination starts about 9:15 a.m. So, he must reach to the Oxford prison before that. Okay. So, he starts moving with all the arrangements. Clear. Evans was leathering his face vigorously when Stephens brought in two small square tables and set them opposite each other in the narrow space between the bunk on the one side and on the other a distempered stone wall. Next, Stephens brought in two hard chairs, the slightly less battered, of which he placed in front of the table which stood near the cell door. Jackson put in a brief final appearance. "Behave yourself, laddie." Evans turned and nodded. "And these," Jackson pointed to the pin apps. "Off." Evans turned and nodded again. "I was going to take them down anyway. A minister, isn't he? The chap coming to sit in, I mean." "And how do you know that?" asked Jackson quietly. "Well, I had to sign some forms, didn't I? And I couldn't have." Evans drew the razor carefully down his left cheek and left a neat swath in the white leather. "Can I ask you something, Mr. Jackson? Why did they have to bug me in the cell?" He nodded his head vaguely to a point above the door. "Not a very neat job," considered Jackson. "They're not. They don't honestly think I'm going to try to." "They are taking no chances, Evans. Nobody in his sense would take any chance with you." Evans is getting ready for the examination. That time, Stephen, the junior officer, he brings table and chairs to his cell, okay. That time, Evans comes to know that he is going to write his examination in his cell itself, okay. He looked at Stephen but did not ask anything. Stephen keeps a table, chairs, everything there. He arranges everything for the examination. Understood? That time Jackson says, Stephen, behave yourself. Lady means boy, okay? Behave yourself, like he asks. That time also Evans just nodded his head. Then Jackson asked him to remove the pinups. Some pictures were there on the wall. He asked Evans to remove it. So Evans says that I'm going to remove it. Okay, I know that I'm going to remove it, like he says. And that time Evans asked a question to Mr. Jackson. He asked that a minister is going to come for invigilation. Am I right? He asked that question. Minister means a priest is going to come for invigilation. Am I right? He asked. Who asked? Evans asked to the officer Jackson. Jackson got shocked, okay, and he asked that, how do you come to know that a minister is going to come for invigilation? That time Evans hit him something and he says that I was helpless when you people were asking to put some signature in the papers and all for the examination purpose. That time I saw the name of the invigilator, okay, and he heard something and he says that time only I came to know that a priest is my invigilator, okay, I came to know, like he says. Understood? And after that, Evans again asked another question to Jackson. Mr. Jackson, I want to ask you one thing. Why you people are always locking me inside this cell, okay, at least for this exam, why are you not taking me out of the cell? Why you people are bug me in the cell? Means that why you always lock me inside the cell? He asked. So Jackson replied that you did a great job. That's why we locked you inside the cell. You did a great job. Oh, because of that only we people lock you in the jail. He replies like that. And then see at Evans asked that at least for the examination you people give me a chance to go out and write, okay, you are not thinking that you officers are not thinking that I am really trying to get an academic qualification in my life. You people are not thinking like that. That's why not giving a chance to go out, like Evans says, okay. So that time Jackson replies that nobody will take a chance with you, Evans, because you did like that. Your previous jobs were like that. That's why nobody would take a chance with you. That was the reply given by the officer Jackson. Okay. Who's going to listen in? I tell you who's going to listen in, Daddy. It's the governor himself. See, he doesn't trust you a bloody inch, and nor do I. I'll be watching you like a hawk, Evans, so keep your nose clean, clear. He walked towards the door. Evans nodded. He had already thought of that. And number two handkerchief was lying ready on the bunk. A neatly folded square of white linen. Just one more thing, Einstein. Yeah, what's that? Good luck, old son. In the little lodge just inside the prison's main gates, the Reverend S. McClary signed his name neatly in the visitor's book and then walked side by side with a silent prison officer across the excise yard to D Wing, where he was greeted by Jackson. The wing's heavy outdoor was unlocked and locked behind them. The heavy inner door the same, and McClary was handed into Stephen's keeping. Get the razor, murmured Jackson. Stephen nodded. Well, keep your eyes skinned clear. Stephen nodded again, and McClary, his feet clanging up the iron stairs, followed his new guide and finally stood before a cell door where Stephens opened the peephole and looked through. That's him, sir. Evans, facing the door, sat quietly at the farther of the two tables. His whole attention reverted to a textbook of elementary German grammar. Stephens took the key from its ring and the cell lock sprang back with a thudded metallic twang. Jackson said, nobody wants to take a chance with you, okay? And now again, Evans asked, who's going to listen to me? That means who's going to observe? Invigilator would be there. Apart from invigilator, who all will be there as security officers? Okay, that was his question. So Jackson said that, yes, you know that. Who's going to listen? Yes, of course, the governor himself is going to observe you. And we both, the two officers, okay, Jackson and Stephens also would be here. And like a hawk, We always will keep our eyes on you. So you cannot do any mischievous thing. Understood? Keep your nose clean means that behave properly. Behave in the right way, okay? Not mischievous way, okay? Like that, he asked him. So who is going to observe him? Governor himself and his two officers, Jackson and Stephens, would be here. And always we observe you. You cannot do anything wrong. Understood? Like that, he says. Who says? Jackson, okay? And Evans agrees that time outside the cell, near the main gate, who reached? Yes, our invigilator, Reverend McLaren, reached near the gate. And we people all know that if any visitors come inside the jail, means they must give all their details, okay, their address proof, they must provide there near the gate, okay, the guard would be there. So, when the invigilator reaches there near the gate, he took that visitor's record and starts writing his details and all. He finished writing. After that, the guard allowed him to come inside and hand over Mrs. McLaren to the officer, Stephen. Okay. And now Stephen accompanies him. He also just went with Stephen, who Mr. Reverend McLaren goes with Stephen. Both of them, they go to the cell, okay, Evans' cell. And when they reach near the cell, through the peeping hole, Stephen say that that's the chap. He is that boy, okay, he is shows. And now our invigilator, he looks through the peeping hole and he saw that Evans was sitting there, okay, two tables and chairs arranged there inside the cell, and Evans was just learning some elementary German grammar book he was reading. Means that preparing for the examination, like that the invigilator came to know, okay. And that time also Jackson, in a whispering tone, he asked Stephens to get the razor back, okay. Because the officers, still they are worried about Evans' character, okay. They know that he get a single chance, sure he must utilize it, okay. That's why he asked Stephens to get back the razor, clear. And now the invigilator reaches there, he is just getting inside the cell, okay, for doing his duty. Evans is ready for the examination. He is going to write the German all-over examination because his wish is that he wants to get some academic qualification in his life. Clear. It was 9:10 a.m. when the governor switched on the receiver. He had instructed Jackson to tell Evans of the temporary little privations. That was only fair, as if Evans wouldn't spot it. But wasn't it all a bit theoretical? School boyish almost. How on earth was Evans going to try anything on today? If he was so anxious to make another break, why in heaven's name hadn't he tried it from the recreational block? Much easier, but he hadn't. And there he was now, sitting in a locked cell, all the prison officers on the alert. Two more locked doors between his cell and the yard, and a yard with a wall as high as a haystack. Yes, Evans was as safe as houses. Anyway, it wouldn't be any trouble at all to have the receiver turned on for the next couple of hours or so. It wasn't as if there was going to be anything to listen to, was it? Amongst other things, an invigilator duty was to ensure that the strictest silence was observed. But still that little nagging doubt, might Evans try to take advantage of McLaren, get him to smuggle in a chisel or two or a rope ladder or... The governor sat up sharply. It was all very well getting rid of any potential weapon that Evans could have used. But what about McLaren? What if, quite unwittingly, the innocent McLaren had brought in something himself, a jackknife perhaps? And what if Evans held him hostage with such a weapon? The governor reached for the phone. It was 9:12 a.m. The examiner and the invigilator had already been introduced by Stephens when Jackson came back and shouted to McLaren through the cell door. Can you come outside a minute, sir? You too, Stephens. Jackson quickly explained the governor's worries and McLaren patiently held out his arms at shoulder level lids. Jackson lightly frisked his claws. Something hard here, sir. My reading glasses, replied McLaren, looking down at the spectacle case. Jackson quickly reassured him and, bending down on the landing, thumb flicked the catches on the suitcase. He picked up each envelope in turn, carefully passed his palms along their surfaces and seemed satisfied. He riffled curiously through a few pages of Holy Writ and vaguely shook the Church Times. All right, so far, but one of the objects in McLara's suitcase was puzzling him sorely. Do you mind telling me why you have bought this, sir? He had a smallish semi-inflated rubber ring such as a young child with a waist of about 12 inches might have struggled into. You think of going for a swim, sir? McLaren, hitherto amiable demeanor, was a slightly ruffled by this tasteless little pleasantry, and he answered Jackson somewhat sourly. If you must know, I suffer from hemorrhoids, and when I'm sitting down for any length of time. Very sorry, sir, I didn't mean to The embarrassment was still riddling Jackson's cheek when he found the paper knife at the bottom of the case. I think I had better keep this, though, if you don't mind that, sir. It was 9:18 a.m. before the governor heard their voices again, and it was clear that the examination was going to be more than a little late in getting underway. It was 9:10 a.m. Governor wants to talk to Jackson, okay? Because the final instruction governor wants to give. Why? Still, the governor is worrying about Evans' character, okay? If Evans get a chance, he would utilize it and escape from the jail. So, governor wants to give the final instruction. Still, governor knows that Evans is not a student, okay? Then also, he wants to give the instruction. So, he took the phone and switched on the telephone and calls Jackson to give the final instruction, okay? And still, governor is worrying very much about Evans, whether he would utilize the chance to escape from the jail, okay? That was his thought. At the same time, he himself consoled, okay, to inform Evans about the examination, the governor called him. So Evans came out of the cell and went to governor's office at the beginning. Do you remember? Yes. So through the recreational block only he came. So if Evans wants to escape, that time he would have utilized the chance, okay. But he didn't do anything. Means that he didn't try to escape there. Because that was very easy while coming through the recreational block. If he wants, he would escape. But he didn't do so. Now, Evans is sitting in his jail. Invigilator is there. At the same time, two prison officers also, they are outside the cell. Okay, near the door only, they both were standing. And not only that, after the cell, two more doors also there. And then, if Evans escape from there also, he has to come to the yard. And heavy security there in the guard, in the yard. And not only that, long ward is also there. He cannot jump and go outside, okay, sure, which is not possible at all. This all, the governor himself, he is thinking like this, okay. So, everywhere it's tight security is made. So, Evans is sitting like a house. He cannot go out of the cell or he cannot escape. Why? Because the tight security is made for the examination. Like that, he just consoled himself. Who? The governor. At the same time, now inside the examination hall, they just want to start the examination. But again, governor got the worry, okay? He just starts thinking that, okay, all the securities, everything is made. At the same time, the invigilator is an outsider. He's sitting there. So, sometimes this person, Evans, might be taking this invigilator as an advantage, okay? That means something he just used, if a small rope or knife, something is with this invigilator. If he has something, okay, paper knife or something is with him, sure. Evans would take it and use that weapon to escape, or he just made use of this invigilator to escape. That also can happen. So if any weapons, paper knife or some small weapons are there with McLaren, the invigilator, that the governor wants to know. For that he called Jackson and asked Jackson to frisk the invigilator. Okay, frisk means, you people know that if you are going for the competency exams and all, your body will be frisked, even board examination also, okay, if you are keeping something inside and all. So, that frisking must be done for the invigilator. That was the order given by the governor. So, Jackson came near to the cell door and called McLaren, sir, please, would you just come out, okay, like he asked. So, McLaren came out and he informed the governor's worry, okay, want to check your body or what are the things you bought, we have to check it, okay, because you should not give any weapons and all. The guy is a sort of a person, okay, that he informed. Now, McLaren, the invigilator, he is ready for the frisking. He just raised up his hands and all and he was ready to allow them for frisking. Okay, now Jackson checked every bird, and when he was just touching his body, he kept his hand there in the pocket. Okay, something hard was there. So he asked, what is it? And now McClary said that my reading glasses, my spectacles, I kept there. He showed the case. Okay, the spectacle case was outside and he kept the reading glass there in his pocket. He showed that. And after that, Jackson took his suitcase, McClary's suitcase. I told you, when he just came out of his flat, he kept all the things for the examination arrangement, everything he kept in that suitcase only. So now our officer, prison officer, he just opened that suitcase and took out everything. Okay, that means one by one he starts taking out. Understood? So he saw that paper envelope, paper knife, files, authentication card, and whatever he keeps there, everything, even Bible, church times, everything he just saw. And the officer is really satisfied with the things and all, but only one thing inside the suitcase that puzzled the officer. Okay, that was really confusing. Okay, one thing. Okay, what was that? You know, a rubber tube was kept there inside the suitcase. So the police officer Jackson, he got the doubt that why the invigilator keeps this rubber tube inside the suitcase. What is the purpose of it? He wants to know that. So the police officer, Mr. Jackson, he asked McClary that, sir, if you don't mind, I want to ask you one thing. Why did you keep this rubber ring inside your suitcase? After the examination, are you going for a swim? He asked like that. Because the rubber ring looks like that. You know, small kids used to wear the ring around their waist while going for swimming. Understood? While going for swimming. So, like that tube only, it kept inside a small tube, okay, for using for swimming. That it is kept there inside the suitcase. So our officer, he asked McClary that, sir, after the examination, are you going for a swim? For that purpose, do you keep this rubber tube inside the suitcase? He asked this question. Now, this time McClary got a bit disturbed, okay? He got angry. He asked that, officer, do you want to know the reason why I kept this inside the suitcase? Do you want to know? He asked the question. So Jackson looked at him, the invigilator replied like that, I have hemorrhoid. Hemorrhoid means I have the complaint of piles. Whenever I go, I used to carry this rubber tube with me. Why? Because if for a long time, if I want to sit somewhere, I used to keep this ring on the chair and on top of it only I used to sit. Okay, why? Because I have piles, I cannot sit. Like that he got, he just says, okay, bit angry manner, he replies like that. What he replies? Wherever I go, I used to carry this rubber ring. Why? Because I have hemorrhoid or piles. For a long time, if I want to sit, means I keep this ring, and over that only I used to sit, okay, that's my practice. Is it enough? Like he asked. So that time, Jackson came to know that McClary is angry, okay. So Jackson said that, sorry sir, I didn't mean, okay, no problem, you keep the ring with you, like that he says, okay, and he came out. And that time also inside, the governor could hear the exchanges talking, everything inside the cell. So governor came to know that examination time, we cannot start the examination because still the exchanges are going there inside the cell, means that the preparation is not at completed, okay. So it will take time, on time cannot start the examination, he worries like that, okay. McClary, you have got a watch, Evans? Yes, sir. McClary, I'll be telling you when to start and again when you have 5 minutes left. All right? Silence. McClary, there's plenty more of this writing paper should you need it. Silence. McClary, now write the name of the paper 0211 in the top left-hand corner. Silence. McClary, in the top right-hand corner, write your index number 313 and in the box just below that, write your center number 271. All right? Now, all the preparations is done, okay? You can hear now the conversation between McClary and Evans inside the cell, okay? Because examination is going to begin. Now, McClary asks Evans that, you have a watch. Do you have a watch? So Evans replies, yes, I have a watch. Now McClary again says, I'll tell you when to start and also I'll inform you 5 minutes before the examination when you have to finish. Just 5 minutes before also I'll inform you. Means that the starting and ending time I'll inform you. Okay, that instruction McLaren gives. Silence. Evans did not speak anything. And after that, again, McLaren says that I have a lot of additional sheets in my suitcase. If you want, you can ask. Means that I brought a lot of additional sheets. It's in my suitcase. If you want additional sheet, you can ask. Okay? He gives that instruction also. That time also, Evans keeps silence. Clear? And now, exam begins. So, McLaren starts giving the instruction. He asks Evans, Evans, you must write in the left corner of your paper, okay, left side, you must write the name of the paper as 0211, okay, name of the paper in the left side of your answer sheet, that is 0211, okay. Next, you must write just below it, index number 313, index number 313. Next, you must write sender number 271. You people all know that your board examination also, you must write the sender number, subject code, everything. Okay, for all the board examination, we have this. So here, McLaren gives this instruction to Evans to write in this order. Okay, at the same time, you people must listen carefully. These all, what I am saying, the numbers and all, this is very important because this will take you to the climax. Understood? So now listen. Name of the paper, 20211. And index number 313 and then sender number 271. McLaren asked Evans to write all this in his answer sheet. Okay, means that now the exam begins. Silence. 9:20 a.m. McLaren, I am now going to Evans S, not going to say us is a. McLaren, I don't know about that. I, Stephen, Mr. Jackson, given me strict instructions to Evans. How I am supposed to concentrate on my exam with someone breathing down my neck. Christ. Sorry, sir. I didn't mean. The governor reached for the phone. Jackson? Oh, good. Get Stephens out of this cell, will you? I think we're perhaps overdoing things. As you wish, sir. The governor heard the exchanges in the cell, heard the door clang once more, and heard McLaren announce that examination had begun at last. Now, perfect silence inside the cell. Time is 9:20, okay? McLaren starts speaking. Now, I'm going to... McLaren wants to say something like, now, I'm going to... He starts like, that time, Evans asked immediately, sir, is this person standing inside the cell? Like, he points towards Stephen and asks. Because Stephen was there inside the cell along with McLaren and Evans. Because he got the duty like that only, he must stand near Evans while writing the examination. So Evans says that, sorry sir, to the invigilator he says, sorry sir, somebody is breathing under my neck and I wants to write the examination, means I cannot concentrate in my examination. Means that this person should not be here while writing the examination. That was Evans' request, okay. What he says? Somebody is breathing under my neck. I want to write the examination in that situation. Means I cannot concentrate in my examination. So this person should not be here. That was his request. So Jackson was outside. Stephen was inside the cell. Jackson went near to the phone and he calls to the governor and says what Evans said. Okay. So, governor says that, okay, Jackson, you called Stephen out of the cell and he must stand outside the cell near the door only because we are overdoing the things. Evans would not do anything, okay? We are just giving unnecessary precautions and all we are taking, okay? So, we must stop everything. Now, you called Stephen out of the cell and he must stand outside the cell only, okay? That permission governor gave to Jackson, okay? And now... Jackson came and called Stephen outside the cell. Now both officers are out of the cell. So who is sitting inside? Evans and McLaren, the invigilator. Clear? Now officially the invigilator announces that exam begins. Here ends the first part of our story. Evans Rise and Oliver, written by Colin Dexter. This is for the day. Children, do you think that Evans is really trying to get some academic qualification in his life or any other laid plan behind it? Do you want to know what would have happened in the climax? Wait for some time. I'll be back with the climax of our lesson Be safe until we meet again. Thank you for being with me.